So good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for making time to be here with us, with Dr. Guy Sinclair from the Victoria University of Wellington. I would also really like to thank my colleagues at the Centre for Legal Theory, especially Andrew Halpin, Nicole Rowan, who is now in Auckland, and of course Mark McBride, who advised a lot on how to get things going for this symposium. So today, Guy will be sharing with us his latest work on postcolonial politics of international organizations law, and this feeds on is a spin-off of his book that was published last year on To Reform the World, International Organizations and the Making of Modern States. So why I think Guy's presence in the world of international law is very, very important is because he is a new voice in international legal theory. International law theory has been stagnant for a while, I think. There was a history and theory of international law voice in the early stages of international law. Then it moved towards crits and post-crits. And then in the last 10 years, there was the fragmentation of international law in the field of international legal theory. And Guy's work really breaks new ground, bringing in post-colonial voices, the voices that have always been there, but never really been enunciated in the realm of international law. So with that, let's hear it from you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Cindy, for that lovely welcome. And thank you to the Center for inviting me to speak here. It's a real honor to be invited to speak to the Legal Theory Symposium. I have warm memories of Singapore from when I was newlywed in Oxford and on my way to back to Auckland to finish my law degree. And being a poor student at the time, we had no money to get us to go on honeymoon anywhere except for Singapore on a 3-day stopover, but we had a very lovely romantic time. And since then, it seems like many of my friends have moved to Singapore and made new friends who live in Singapore, so it's lovely to be here. Chin Lee kindly mentioned my book, which was published last year, which focused on the expanding powers of international organizations and their relationship to the making of modern states. And in that book, I tried to construct a theoretical argument about the dynamics of reform linking those two phenomena, the expansion of powers exercised by international organizations and the making of modern states on a model broadly Western but changing over time. And that sort of theoretical argument was constructed on the back of a series of close historical studies. I want to develop a different argument today. It's also about international organizations, it's also about using history to draw out theoretical insights, but it's not an argument that's well developed in the book, and so it's a new one I'm trying out with you, and I look forward to having a discussion with you about its merits or otherwise. And my argument today is that the common sense that international lawyers have about the origins of international organizations law is all wrong. That it's wrong on the history, and as a result, it wrongly estimates the politics of the field, and it wrongly assesses the theoretical foundations of the discipline or subdiscipline or field, or whatever you want to call it, this strange thing, international organizations law. So the normal story about international organizations law is that it's more or less a European invention, around 1918-19, maybe earlier. But my argument is that international organizations law is a creation of the post-colonial era, profoundly shaped by decolonization and infused with a logic that is post-colonial in nature, if I may say. So this argument has important implications, I think, both practical and theoretical. Practically, it relates to problems in international organizations law today, including difficulties in holding international organizations responsible for violations of international law. And we think most prominently of cases such as the introduction of cholera by UN peacekeepers to Haiti and the thousands of deaths that resulted, or sexual misconduct and sexual crimes by UN peacekeepers in different parts of the world. So that's the practical side of it. Theoretically, the paper that I'm about to present tries to understand the colonial and post-colonial dynamics of international organizations law, which hasn't been done before. So a lot of work has been done on particular international organizations and their colonial origins or their post-colonial origins. A lot has been done on international law in general, but not a lot on the law of international organizations as a specific subfield or discipline of international law. So I want to try to understand the agency of non-Western actors in the making of international organizations law, while recognizing at the same time the way that international law generally, including international organizations law, has been used against non-Western actors. So let me start, this is a big warm-up, let me start by trying to define international organizations law. And it turns out that it's not easy to define. I'm saying international organizations law is shorthand, but sometimes people call it law of international organizations, sometimes international institutional law. I'll just say international organizations law. There's a lot of variation among not just the terminology, but the practitioners, how practitioners have used that term, or those terms, how theorists have thought about it, and over time how that has all played out. For present purposes, I want to say that international organizations law has two key features, and maybe a third that I'll just dangle to come back to a little bit later. So the first feature is international organizations lawyers have a shared definition of their subject matter, an international organization. So that definition is expressed slightly differently by different people, but in general terms, you can say they define international organizations as public or intergovernmental organizations formed between states on the basis of a treaty or other international instrument, governed by international law, and possessing international legal personality, sometimes expressed as organs capable of expressing their will. So a shared definition of international of their subject matter, international organization, and then secondly, a comparative approach to examining international organizations. So typically you'll find in a book on international organizations law a series of headings which are basically cross-cutting issues affecting different international organizations, such as legal personality, interpretation and amendment of constituent instruments, membership, organs, powers, decision-making, financing, and so on and so forth. So a shared definition and a comparative approach. Very thin definition of international organizations law. The field is often also characterized by a so-called functional orientation, which at the very least is an assumption that international organizations have been created to meet the needs of states. And that orientation, or that theory, sometimes it's called a theory, sometimes it's called an ideology, sometimes it's called something else, has been used to explain a number of features of international organizations law, the extent of international organizations' powers, how they're interpreted, their privileges and immunities, and other things. A more expansive version of functionalism is expressed in the assumption that international organizations are actually good things, that they're good things in the world doing good. And therefore, by implication, international organizations law itself is critical to the goal of constructing a peaceful, lawful world. As I said, some have suggested that this idea of functionalism amounts to a theory of international organizations law. I'm a little bit skeptical of that claim. And as I'll argue a little bit later on, important aspects of the functionalism of international organizations law have been overlooked. So the usual story I mentioned earlier is that international organizations law is a European creation of the early 20th century. And so David Kennedy has talked about the move to institutions in 1990. I promise I only have a few slides, most of them are pictures, and couple of them as one long quote. So the idea that 1918-1919 marked a sort of turning point or a break in international relations, the move to institutions exemplified by the League of Nations, perhaps to a lesser extent, the International Labour Organization. But you find in textbooks on international organizations law that such these textbooks are usually they usually begin with a sketched history of international organizations, and that history often goes back further than just 1919, and it becomes some expansive, quickly told story that is also very European in focus. So sometimes it goes back as far as the Greeks and the Romans and suggests that early forms of cooperation among Greek city-states should be understood as international organizations. Then it will skip forward through time to the 14th century, the Hanseatic League of northern Germany on the North Sea. Of course, it'll stop over in 1648. The Peace of Westphalia seems to play a part in the story of international organizations. Then we have 1815, the Vienna Congress, the 1899 and 1907 Hague conferences, and along the way they spend quite a bit of time talking about the public international unions of the 19th century, like the International Telegraph Union, first meeting in 1865, pictured here. And in telling that story, there's a sense that the law of international organizations grew up along with these international organizations. So often early theorists like Pierre Kazansky or Paul Reinsch or Gustave Monnier or Louis Renault from the 19th century or early 20th century are mentioned as early theorists of international organizations law. But the story usually reaches its climax again back in 1918-1919, the Treaty of Versailles and the establishment of the League of Nations. So a very European story, a very European imaginary. In some sense, this all makes sense. What's wrong with it? So in this paper, I try to make an argument about what's wrong with this story in three steps. And you could take it as three provocations, if you like. The first provocation is that there was no international organizations law before World War II. So the birth of international organizations law coincided with a period of rapid and accelerating decolonization. The second argument is that international organizations law in its formation from World War II onwards was profoundly influenced by the fact of decolonization in its practice, in its case law, in its early doctrinal scholarship. The third argument is that international organizations law is deeply imbued with this, is what I call a post-colonial logic. And that logic, in a surprising, perhaps paradoxical way, actually precedes the World War II turning point. And I'll try to explain how that works. So a kind of intellectual history with theoretical implications. Step one, provocation one. No international organizations law before World War II. So to those who are familiar with the field, this might sound counterintuitive, if not objectionable, more outrageous. So here's my argument in a nutshell. In a nutshell, before sometime around World War II, perhaps during World War II, international lawyers had no shared conception of what an international organization was, and therefore the core feature, the core comparative methodology of international organizations law was not possible. No shared definition, no shared comparative methodology, which, as you'll recall, are the two main features of international organizations law subdefined. So I'll argue a little bit later that the functional orientation began a little bit before World War II, as I mentioned. Before World War II, if we look at the legal scholarship on international organizations, we find two uses of that term. The term international organization is used, but not in the sense that we think of it today. So the first use is a very broad use of the term. So international organization is used to mean basically the overall structure of international relations. So it included, in some uses, federal states, for some reasons, so the United States is an example, in some uses of an international organization. But broader than that, it encompassed things like the balance of power, or the concert of Europe in the 19th century. It's also used, the term international organization is also used in a more specific sense to mean a particular institution. But here the term is used more loosely than we would today. So it's used to encompass both governmental and non-governmental, public and private, and hybrid public-private international organizations as we think of them today. An example of this is the 1921 League of Nations Handbook of International Organizations, which lists hundreds and hundreds of different international organizations, but if you look closely at them, many of them are really private associations, even sporting clubs, things that we would not think of as an international organization today. So without a shared definition of international organization in the sense that I just defined it earlier, public organization established between states on the basis of a treaty or other international instrument, governed by international law, personality and so on. Without that shared definition, no real comparative work was possible. We find a few scattered attempts, we can come back to those if you like, but most of those, if not all, included both public and private organizations, and they all come to this conclusion that, well, it's too diverse. These kinds of entities are too diverse to draw any general conclusions. Now, somebody familiar with the law of international organizations will say, well, what about the advisory opinions of the Permanent Court of International Justice in the 1920s and 1930s? These opinions, some of those opinions, are often read today as early cases in international organizations law. But if we look at them closely, there's no real evidence of a consciousness of such a thing. So, for example, there are a series of opinions on the competence of the International Labour Organization, often taken to be early cases in international organizations law. But these really involve a careful interpretation of Part 13 of the Treaty of Versailles, which is a constituent instrument of the International Labour Organization. And there's no suggestion in them that the conclusions that they're drawing have any wider application to any other international organization. Another case, the European Commission of the Danube. It's tempting to read that case today with a present-day understanding of international organizations. But in that case, we see the Permanent Court of International Justice referring to the European Commission of the Danube as one of a wide variety of international entities, some of which have personality, legal personality, some of which don't. Some of which have privileges, some of which don't. So again, no shared understanding of the core subject matter. If one grants that there was no mention of international organization law before, say, World War II, are there any other possible candidates? Is this just a matter of terminology? We find reference in the literature of the time to something called international administrative law. I won't dwell on it too long. In some ways, it shares some features with international organizations law. But again, it's very broad. It includes both public and private entities. And it's a bit more like what we think of today as global administrative law, or perhaps transgovernmental networks, a la Amaury's law. Again, there's something mentioned sometimes called international constitutional law. Again, that might sound like something like international organizations law. Manley O. Hudson is the most well-known proponent of that idea. But this turns out to be too narrow when compared to what we think of as international organizations law today. He defines international constitutional law as arising out of particular disputes and the opinions of the Permanent Court of International Justice. But we think of international organizations as much broader, having much more to do with the constituent instruments of the organizations themselves and their practices. Why then would we think that World War II is a turning point? Why would it be a turning point in the emergence of international organizations? Well, it was a period of intensive reflection and planning by both international lawyers and states. New constituent instruments had to be written up for the United Nations Relief and Rehabilitation Administration, 1943, the International Monetary Fund, International Bank for Reconstruction and Development, 1944. 1944, the United Nations itself, 1945, and so on and so forth. So there was this massive effort by international lawyers and by government officials to reflect on the experience of the previous 20 years and more, and to sort of regularize their practices, to draw up instruments that had similar features, that were governed by international law, that provided for legal personality, explicitly or implicitly, and so on. We find here also growing precision in the terminology. So the constituent instruments of the International Monetary Fund and the IBRD use the term international organization in the sense that we use it today. A key figure in this development or this emergence of international organizations law is a guy named Clarence Wilfred Jenks, who was the legal advisor for the International Labour Organization, a Cambridge graduate, a friend of Hirsch Lauterbach, who wrote a series of articles on different cross-cutting features of international organizations, and then in 1945 wrote a long article called Some Constitutional Problems of International Organizations, which really sets out the agenda for the discipline going forward for the next, for the decades to come. So it sets out topic after topic in roughly the same way that we would find in the contents of a book on international organizations law today, and it applies the comparative methodology that is characteristic of the discipline. So around the same time, we find scholars recognizing the emergence of this discipline. Jenks in 1945 talks about the law of international institutions. Georg Schwarzenberger in 1945 talks about international institutional law. And Alger Hiss, famous for another reason, talks about the adjectival law of international organizations in 1947. So it comes into being at this time. And then we see, in the cases of the International Court of Justice in the decade or two following the end of World War II, those cases giving content to the discipline on issues like membership, powers, interpretation, decision-making, and personality, and so on. Perhaps the most important case was the 1949 opinion of the International Court of Justice on reparation of injuries, important for establishing the international legal personality of the United Nations and the doctrine of implied powers, but also interesting because in discussing the doctrine of implied powers, it drew on the earlier case law of the Permanent Court of International Justice on the International Labour Organization, thereby asserting a sort of a trans-institutional principle that would come to underlie the discipline. Okay, we find the first textbooks on the discipline being written in those few decades following World War II. You may be convinced by this argument, you may not. Let me say that my arguments are cumulative and standalone, if that's possible. Number two, international organizations law was profoundly shaped by decolonization in several ways. In practice, in its jurisprudence and in its doctrinal scholarship. And let me run through the practice very quickly. I think this is actually quite well known, that international organizations, the UN, most prominent among them, became focal points for the political and legal struggles over decolonization. And three areas of practice stand out in particular. Practice around decolonization itself, so the application of the trusteeship system that was embedded in the UN Charter, the application of the Chapter 11 mechanism provided for non-self-governing territories, and the emergence of sanctions that were applied to states such as South Africa that was seen as recalcitrant on the matter of decolonization. So decolonization. Secondly, social and economic development, the emergence of new organs, new subsidiary bodies, new international organizations targeting social and economic development, in particular for new states. And then peace and security. The issue of non-alignment, for example, which was a policy that was adopted by many of the new states that came to independence in the years following World War II. One thinks about the United for Peace resolution of 1950, which was really an example of although it was proposed by an American Secretary of State, it was really made possible by the rallying of new states who saw the resolution as an opportunity to assert their position in the world as against the great powers. And the same with the emergence of peacekeeping, an opportunity for these new and smaller states to play a role on the stage on issues of peace and security. Okay, so I said practice and jurisprudence. Now, I won't spend a long time going into case after case, but we can come back to it in the Q&A. But what we see in the key cases of the International Court of Justice, the key advisory opinions of the International Court of Justice in the, say, two, 3 decades following World War II, is that most, if not all of them, arose out of circumstances of decolonization. Again, think about reparations for injuries, 1949, arising from issues surrounding the end of the British mandate in Palestine. Think about the UN admission cases, important for membership and interpretation issues, which arose out of the use of the veto power to block admission of new states. Think about certain expenses, 1962, important on issues of interpretation and implied powers, arising out of peacekeeping at the end of empire in the Suez and in the Congo. And of course, the Southwest Africa opinions, series of opinions which address all sorts of important issues, succession between international organizations, powers, the legal nature of instruments produced by international organizations, all arose out of dispute over South Africa's mandate over Southwest Africa, Namibia. So practice, jurisprudence, and doctrinal scholarship. Those practices, those disputes, those advisory opinions that I've just mentioned very quickly, all informed a burgeoning scholarship on international organizations law. But what's less well appreciated, I think, is the extent to which non-Western jurists contributed to that scholarship. So often when we think about the beginnings of the earliest textbooks of international organizations law, we think of people like the Frenchman Paul Reuter, or the Englishman D.W. Bowert, or Henry Skirmes from the Netherlands. And what gets overlooked is how many books were written on the field by non-Western scholars on important issues, cross-cutting issues in international organizations law, voting procedures, termination of membership, privileges and immunities, and so on and so forth. Some of these scholars examined particular international organizations. Of course, the United Nations was a favorite, but typically they adopted this comparative approach, which was characteristic of this emerging field. And they revealed concerns, again, stemming from issues related to decolonization. So let me give you some examples. And here again, I have some pictures. Wellington Koo, a Chinese diplomat who later served on the International Court of Justice, in 1947 wrote a treatise on voting procedures in international organizations. And he framed the issue as centering on the concept of equality of independent states in international organizations. Discussing the debate over Security Council voting procedures in the UN Charter as, quote, a battle between the great powers and the small powers. Hun Da Qiu, who wrote a book on the treaty making power of international organizations in 1966, another Chinese scholar from Taipei, spent a lot of his career at the University of Maryland, was very conscious of the importance of this issue, treaty making powers to decolonize states. So his book includes lengthy discussions of trusteeship agreements, agreements relating to technical assistance and other aspects of development, of course, issues really close to the heart of international organizations. Now, Gendra Singh, his book in 1957 on the termination of membership in international organizations, focused on the position of mainland China. Rahmatullah Lokano, I don't have a good photograph of him, 1970, his book on implied powers in the United Nations, stated that his motivations for writing the book stemmed from the charge that Afro-Asian states in General Assembly were forcing the organization to take irresponsible positions, and that doubts had been raised by the UN about the UN's competence in relation to Rhodesia, Kashmir, South Africa, and the Congo. Again, questions of decolonization at the heart of the development of this discipline. Obed Asamoah, 1966, wrote a book on General Assembly declarations. He later became Foreign Minister and Attorney General of Ghana. And again, explicitly set his discussion in the intellectual context of decolonization. He noted that economic nationalism among the communists and new nations had challenged the traditional principles of state responsibility. And he argued that these political developments called for swift changes in the law. He further argued that General Assembly declarations had multifaceted legal significance as interpretation and application of international law, as subsequent practice, as an aid in the judicial interpretation of the Charter, as evidence of custom or general principles, and as agreements. And he took as his case studies a series of declarations with particular relevance to new states, including resolutions on the granting of independence to colonial countries and peoples, the elimination of all forms of racial discrimination, permanent sovereignty over natural wealth and resources, and more. Step. Perhaps I should say provocation three. International organizations law is deeply imbued with post-colonial logic. So recent theoretical work has argued that problems facing international organizations such as those that I mentioned earlier about responsibility and so on, are due to the functionalist paradigm or functionalist theory, which Jan Klavers has defined as a, among others, has defined as a principal agent theory. So I don't disagree with the analysis put forward by people who argue that, but I think, and I argue, it downplays an important element of functionalism, and that we can't properly appreciate the appeal of functionalism, therefore we can't properly deal with the problems in international organizations law unless we take into consideration this aspect of functionalism. And the aspect that I want to talk about is that the functional logic of international organizations law is understood as opposed to the territorial logic of imperialism. And I argue in the paper that this can be seen in theoretical work on international organizations beginning as early as the late 19th century. So even Pierre Kazansky in 1897 is saying, is arguing against the idea of a world state and saying these international organizations, he's talking about the public international unions, he's saying these are just international administrative bodies. Our own dream, he says, is the decentralized administrative organization of humanity. And he expressed the hope that our globe will never be governed by some single political center. So he's contrasting these new, what he's calling administrative bodies, with the threat of a world state or a world empire. Paul Ranch in 1911 says something similar. He's averse to any attempts artificially to create a world state, either by the deadening force of military empire or by mechanical construction. Pittman Potter, an American professor of political science and international law who later became professor of international organization at the Graduate Institute in Geneva in the 1930s, wrote a book called Introduction to the Study of International Organization, which was hugely influential in shaping the conception of international organizations in this way. And this is my long quote that I'm putting up. Because I think it illustrates, pertinent to discussion of the problems in international organizations. Pittman Potter is talking about, again, international organizations as a kind of via media between, on the one hand, world statehood or world empire, and on the other hand, international anarchy. This is what he says. International organization is not the only possible type of world unity. Two other forms of world unity are always to be reckoned with, namely empire and cosmopolitanism. Cosmopolitanism, he says, tends towards anarchy. So on one side, we have the world state, or empire. On the other hand, cosmopolitanism. But cosmopolitanism tends towards anarchy. Standing between empire and cosmopolitanism, we have international organization, which takes the national state as a permanent unit and expects neither its subjugation nor its disappearance by the sublimation of the principle of nationality. This principle, this logic of international organizations as something in between neither empire nor anarchy, runs through the doctrine, runs through the discipline, as a kind of a hidden thread that's really not often remarked on, if ever. We find it in the practice of international organizations, in the ways states' representatives talk about international organizations, the fear of international organizations becoming a form of world statehood, expressed in the 1920s in relation to the International Labour Organization. We find it expressed in the idea of functionalism associated with David Mitrany in international relations in the 1930s and 1940s. We find it in UN practice, an anxiety not to conflate international organizations with sovereign states. For example, in the drafting of Article 104 of the Charter, which concerns the legal capacities of the organization. Drafted, as Wilfred Jenks says, to avoid any implication that the United Nations will in any sense be a superstate. We find it in the drafting, in the language of the International Court of Justice in the Reparation for Injuries opinion in 1949. We find it in discussions around the principle of attributed powers or speciality. So I sort of discuss all of this and give you the examples and in the paper. But let me end on this point. What is the appeal of functionalism? What is the appeal of functionalism? And why do I call it a post-colonial logic in international organizations? Well, to states and scholars from the global south, it seems obvious, I think. The idea that international organizations were there to support nation states, not to support empires, had a natural appeal. It appeared to fortify their political project to dismantle colonialism in the decades following World War II. It cut across the imperial structure of international relations that existed up until World War II. And it supported the idea of international organizations serving as vehicles of decolonization and post-colonial state building. What about for scholars and states in the global north? Well, it also aligned with the American policy, the open door trade policy that necessitated the breakdown of imperial trading blocs. So it aligned with the interests of at least some northern states, if not all. But it had another dimension to it. For many in the West, including many international lawyers, decolonization was a threat. It was a threat to international peace, and it was a threat to international legal order. But for these scholars, these international lawyers from the West, the idea of functionally oriented international organizations provided a way through that crisis. It provided a way to justify international organizations that would socialize the new states, that would tutor them into the ways of international law. So for Jenks, Wilfred Jenks, the law of international organizations was no less than, quote, the law governing the constitutional framework of a developing world community. Okay, so I've argued through this series of these three steps, or provocations, as I've said, that the law of international organizations was constituted as a post-colonial discipline. In the most straightforward sense, it came into being, I say, at the time, synchronized with that time of accelerating decolonization following World War II. Not during the interwar period, not during. At a more meaningful level, I'm arguing that much of the practice, the jurisprudence, and the doctrinal scholarship of international organizations law was shaped and emerged from the struggles over decolonization. And more theoretically, I'm arguing that the functional logic of international organizations law should be understood as post-colonial in as much as it cuts across, it opposes the territorial logic of colonialism and empires. And that this should be seen as fundamental to the appeal of the law of international organizations, fundamental to the appeal of the law of international organizations to states and jurists from both the global north and south. The law of international organizations obviously continues to be shaped by the post-colonial period we're living through. Think of the major areas of practice that cause problems in international organizations all today. Think of peacekeeping. Think of Haiti and those issues, some of the issues that arise out there. Think of World Bank-sponsored projects in developing countries that give rise to other kinds of questions of responsibility. I end the paper on an point that I'm very happy to engage with you all on and see, I'd like to see what you think. But what I'm trying to argue there is that the problems faced by international organizations today, it's not simply a matter of this sort of principal-Asia relationship, but it goes more to the heart of this the logic that I've been arguing underlies this area of law. So what I'm saying, what I'm trying to argue there, is that to the extent that international organizations no longer serve the project of state formation, driven by that idea of functionalism, they've come under increasing fire. So on the one hand, criticisms of international organizations and the failure of international organizations law have been especially acute where functional and territorial logics have become blurred. Again, think about an increasing number of UN peacekeeping operations which have effectively become modes of territorial governance. Or think about development projects that involve large-scale environmental changes and the forcible removal of populations. Again, where the functional, so-called functional activities of international organizations have been extended to embrace the effective governance of territories. On the other hand, the functionalist focus on serving particular needs of states has paradoxically resulted in the untrammeled growth of powers exercised by international organizations and a corresponding disaggregation of state functions. So the dilemma currently faced by the law of international organizations is how to retain its political energy that I have argued derives from the post-colonial moment, while addressing this new set of challenges that also emerge from that very origins and logic of the discipline. So I look forward to having a robust discussion with you about all of that. Thank you.
Thank you.